Good evening and welcome to Wion. World is One. I'm Palki Sharma Upadhyay, and tonight we're bringing you a very special interview, in fact this evening, with Namal Rajapaksa. He is a member of parliament in Sri Lanka and the son of Mr. Mahinda Rajapaksa, who took oath as Prime Minister of Sri Lanka last Friday. Good evening, Namal. Thank you very much for being with us. The question that we've been asking here is, does Sri Lanka have a legitimate Prime Minister now? Does it have two?
Well, President Sirisena has taken his decision according to the Constitution. So he has acted upon the rights the President has in the Constitution. So it is a legitimate appointment, and President Rajapaksa is a legitimate Prime Minister of Sri Lanka. And he has already taken his office and started work. The Cabinet is coming in, swearing in yesterday, today and tomorrow. So already the Speaker himself has accepted President Rajapaksa as the Prime Minister and to allocate the Parliament seat that is there for the Prime Minister. So all these are more than enough valid reasons for people to believe that he is a legitimate Prime Minister.
I'm not sure the President can decide who will be the Prime Minister. Your father's appointment, Namal, as Prime Minister of Sri Lanka is being called the first such unconstitutional transfer of power. Do you agree?
I do not agree on that, because the President has clearly acted upon the Constitution, the rights he has. This President can dissolve the Cabinet anytime he wishes. I mean, dissolving the Cabinet includes the Prime Minister as well. And then once you dissolve the Cabinet, once you dissolve the Prime Minister, the President can appoint a new Prime Minister. That is totally constitutional. And in the past, if you look at what happened to President Ranil Wickremesinghe in 2001, 2002, during President Chandrika's government, it's the same thing.
The President can dissolve the Cabinet, but there are certain provisions. And let me read out from what the Sri Lankan Constitution says. It has clear provisions stipulating that the Prime Minister can be removed only if the government has been defeated at the formal statement of its policy during the first sitting of a new parliamentary session, at the presentation of the budget, or through a no-confidence vote. As far as I know, none of this has happened.
The same Constitution clearly says in Section 42, 43, if I'm not mistaken, or subject to correction, that President can reshuffle the Cabinet. So once the reshuffle in the Cabinet includes the Prime Minister himself.
But this was not a reshuffle. He removed the Prime Minister.
Removal happened the way of reshuffling the Cabinet.
Has this happened before in Sri Lanka? The simultaneous reshuffling, as you call it, and removal of Prime Minister and the reinstatement of another man as Prime Minister in less than 24 hours.
It has happened in the past. I mean, that is all depend on the decisions taken by the head of state or the political leadership in the country. So President Sirisena has addressed the nation and given his valid reasons why he took the decision. And it's purely based on the national interest of this country and the national security of Sri Lanka. And he has acted upon the Constitution, and he has consulted senior lawyers prior to doing this. And he addressed the nation and mentioned that by addressing the nation, that he consulted the senior councillors before we actually take coming this decision.
This is the same President who pledged to end the executive powers of the presidency, calling them unconstitutional and also saying that these are anti-democratic, they lead to political instability, and now he's chosen to do what he's done. Would you at least agree, Namal, that there is a constitutional crisis in Sri Lanka because one man who was Prime Minister refuses to leave, saying he will go to court, and another man has been reinstated as Prime Minister?
No, there is no constitutional crisis in Sri Lanka, but of course there is a political crisis in Sri Lanka, because once you have been sent out, the former Prime Minister is refusing to accept that. Once you are defeated, once you have been asked to go. And with all due respect to Prime Minister, former Prime Minister Ranil Wickremesinghe, you know, he should act more responsible and more mature in this kind of political situation. And once the Speaker himself has allocated the Prime Minister's seat to the current Prime Minister, you know, which gives more than enough indication that the former Prime Minister Ranil Wickremesinghe, at least now, stopped playing his political survival game within his party. And act more mature and take responsible decisions.
It's all very well to encourage others to take responsible decisions and act maturely. Did the President have to suspend Parliament? Does that not undermine the legitimacy of Mr. Rajapaksa's appointment? When he's appointed as Prime Minister, the Parliament has to be suspended.
The President has his reason for suspension of Parliament, and for suspension of Parliament is not for a long period of time. If you look at President Premadasa, when he was the head of state, when there was an impeachment brought against him, to the parliament. He suspended for a month to get away from the impeachment at that time. But this is not suspending parliament because you want to get away from getting sacked or getting impeachment. President Sirisena suspended parliament for a few days, 11 days. Anyway, parliament was due on the 5th of November. So the suspension should start from 5th of November to 16th of November. So that decision was purely based on take certain decisions, appoint the cabinet, and come up with a strong, steady policy statement. It will be presented to the parliament. As I earlier said, the JO or the SLPP or the SLP did not form this coalition, this government, just because we want to form a government. We formed this government to work on an understanding to bring back social, political, and economic stability to Sri Lanka. So in order to do that, we need a reasonable time to put things on paper. So this is why the parliament was provoked.
It was suspended because Mr. Rajapaksa did not have the numbers to prove majority on the floor of the House. And now it has been reconvened, so one is assuming that he's found those numbers.
Well, I mean, see, that is the argument is brought by Honorable Ranil Wickremesinghe, but he should know it better because he knows how many his own members have already joined President Rajapaksa. But at the same time, all these arguments will be over when the parliament is summoned and when we can sort this out on the floor. So I think Honorable Ranil Wickremesinghe, he has his own struggle within his own political party, because as we can hear, we can see on papers, we can read, you know, there's a political struggle at the moment going on in the UMP. So for him to survive, you know, he need to play his cards. So that's what he's doing at the country's cost.
Even political experts are saying, Namal, that there were fears of horse trading, and the fact that the parliament has been reconvened, one is assuming. So let me put that question to you straight away. Does Mr. Rajapaksa now have the numbers to prove majority on the floor of the Sri Lankan parliament?
We always had the number. I mean, we took this, President Sirisena and former President Rajapaksa took this decision when the numbers were confirmed. We always had the numbers.
So all the preparation had been done, but now you're saying the parliament had to be suspended because some important decisions relating to the cabinet had to be taken. If you'd done the math in advance, if they'd figured out who is going to be the next prime minister, I'm sure these other the two stories don't add up, I'm afraid.
No, because see, the choosing a cabinet is something bigger, and choosing a prime minister is something that discussion that took between the two leaders, right? And what we're going to do for the next couple of months, and this is at the end of the year. So you can't just summon parliament and say, hey, listen, I have a new prime minister, please present the budget. Within 48 hours, you can't do that. You need a reasonable time to do a budget or do a supplementary budget and then get ready, come up with your policy statement for next 6 months, because we don't want the same political, economic instability that had during Honorable Wickremesinghe's government. We know one of the main reasons why President Sirisena's and Honorable Ranil Wickremesinghe's government were unstable, because they did not agree on policy. So we are a coalition party, SLPP and many parties. Now SLPP has joined us. So we need to discuss based on what policy that we are going to move forward. We need to discuss our foreign policy. We need to discuss our economic policy and what benefits, what packages we are going to bring in. What are we going to give to the investors? What relief we are going to give to the public, because we all know there's an unreasonable tax burden among the Sri Lankan community. So we need to come up with all these proper, strong proposals before we go into the parliament. So that's why President Sirisena took this decision.
Experts both in Sri Lanka and outside who we've been speaking to say that this transition is bad news for Sri Lanka. Let me quote from one of those reports. It says the struggle for power jeopardizes progress on reforms, on ethnic reconciliation and prospects for peaceful and fair elections in 2019.
See, I must ask this person what reforms have taken place for the last 3.5 years. They promised a constitution, but it was never brought in. They promised to rehabilitate and release the prisoners. That was never took place. This government, former government, was there for 3.5 years. And what reforms did they do? They postponed local provincial council elections from 2.5 years. They postponed local council elections for more than 1 year now. Seven promises out of nine is dissolved. For last 1 year, there is no election. So where was democracy at then?
I have to.
The test of democracy is elections, right? So, but did did President Honorable Ranil Wickremesinghe's government hold elections? No. And did they go for constitutional amendment? No. They did not do anything. But now, all of a sudden, they're talking about democracy, they're talking about constitutional amendments, they're talking about introducing new laws and regulations in this country, which was not done for the last 3.5 years.
Sure, I have to agree with you that they did not do all the things that they said they will do. The president here, who has reinstated Mr. Rajapaksa, when he was elected on a platform of democratic renewal and reconciliation. He clearly said that he will hold your family accountable for what he called alleged corruption, assassinations and war crimes. And it's interesting that now Mr. Rajapaksa is coming back to power as prime minister with support from the very same man.
See, he investigated us for 3.5 years. I was in remand for thrice. They investigated, including my grandmother. They went around the world looking for an $18 billion account. And they went around the country looking for assets. In court, in open court, when they were cross-examined, the witnesses in open court mentioned that they were forced by the police to give evidence against us. So they formed this illegal institution called FCIP under the Procurement Act of the police, right? And then had the headquarters in the temple place, and Ranil Wickremesinghe, the prime minister, decided which case to go there. And they interrogated the witnesses, forced them to give false evidence, and yet they failed in courts. So all these corruption allegations were investigated for the last 3.5 years. And now the court itself, in certain cases, has acquitted us, right? And there are certain cases, when you look at the evidence that is given by the witnesses, they clearly say that they were forced by the police. So they tried to manipulate, they tried to create stories, they tried to build stories, they tried to build cases, but it all failed.
Okay.
So now I think President Sirisena might have realized that Ranil Wickremesinghe, the prime minister, was trying to play politics with the judiciary.
Well, politicians play politics. Namal, I have two sets of reports in front of me right now. One is an old report which quotes you as saying that India's influence in Sri Lankan elections cannot be ignored. India is important in regional politics. We cannot ignore India's influence. The second report says that in the past 48 hours, former Sri Lankan President Mahinda Rajapaksa has sent feelers to meet Indian officials, and New Delhi has so far decided to not intervene. Can you confirm either of these? Have you tried to reach out to New Delhi? What is Mr. Rajapaksa's position going to be vis-a-vis India if he is indeed confirmed as the Prime Minister?
Well, I think the second question should be asked by the Foreign Ministry, because the Foreign Minister is not in SA. So it's up to the Foreign Ministry and the Foreign Minister to decide on which state, on what are the official and state official visits that the Prime Minister is going to visit. But yes, of course, Indian influence in the region is very important, and the coexistence, the relationship between India and the region is something that we were always interested in. And India has to play a bigger role when it comes to our region development and to uplift the lives and to do infrastructure projects in the region that we always believe. And I know during my father's government, before 2015, there was a misperception or misinterpretation of his policies. But we want to think about the future, not about the past. So we want to put things right. So we will always stand by our policy on non-aligned. So we will always be non-aligned, and we invite all the investors to come and invest. And Sri Lankan India relationship has always been strong, robust and resilient. And we will always make sure that robust and resilient relationship continues.
I think non-alliance will be easier said than done. You cannot be non-aligned when you have so much of Chinese money flowing into Sri Lanka. China virtually endorsed Mr. Rajapaksa as the new Prime Minister of Sri Lanka, one of the first to do so after what we saw on Friday. So is the policy vis-a-vis China also going to see some change?
No, we will always have a friendly relationship with all our countries. That's why we believe in non-aligned policy. We have economic partners. We do have economic partners. And if you look at Indian economy, how much Chinese money has invested in India, it's huge. So economic partners are there. You can't ask a country to stop your economic partners and stop your economic development in your country. No, we can't do that. We need to invite all the nations that are willing to invest in Sri Lanka to come and invest. We are more than welcome for any sort of investments from India to come in. In fact, my father, I must remind you this, my father offered Hambantota port to India first. Mathal airport to India. Since it never took place, took off from ground, no, we have to go to China. But our relationship with the world is based on non-aligned policy. So India, Sri Lanka has a special place. We have been the neighbors for a long time, and we do have a very strong political, social, and cultural background. Our cultures are similar. So there is nothing for India to worry about any sort of investment coming into Sri Lanka, because my father has always been very clear that he will not use or allow Sri Lankan water, air, or sea to be used against any of our neighboring countries.
The very same port that you mentioned is on a 99-year lease with China because the Sri Lankans couldn't repay the debt. Does that not worry you, the increasing reports and noises about the Chinese debt trap in this region?
Well, I think the Prime Minister, former Prime Minister Ranil Wickremesinghe himself mentioned in Vienna that there is no Chinese debt trap. And himself and the port minister both reiterated that the Hambantota port was given on 99-year lease based on a policy decision government at that time, not because they couldn't pay the debt. It was reiterated, endorsed by the former Prime Minister and the port minister.
The Speaker of Parliament has warned of possible bloodshed. There have been reports of clashes. Do you fear more violence, Namal, in the days ahead?
There won't be any violence because our president, the current president of this country, President Maithripala Sirisena, has acted according to the constitution. There is no violence in Sri Lanka in regard to this political crisis, but this is not a constitutional crisis. This is a political crisis. Political crises are normal in any part of the world. You go to Brexit, they went through a political turbulence. You go to India, there were certain times where India went through political turbulence. You go to any country, you go to US, you go to any country, you know, there are certain periods of time in the country where you go political turbulence, but for going through political turbulence doesn't mean there is violence always. So same speaker has issued a statement today that he recognized and allocated the Prime Minister's seat to President Rajapaksa.
What is going to be the first priority of Mr. Rajapaksa?
Well, we are seriously discussing on certain issues, in a nutshell. We are looking at bringing back the economic, social and political stability. That is one of the key things that President Rajapaksa will be concentrating. And of course, yes, the rehabilitation of former city cadres to take place and continue as he was doing before, because his government has rehabilitated more than 12,500 LTT cadres, only few left at the moment. So we are looking at seriously considering on a rehabilitation program on that. And of course, the constitutional amendments, you know, within one Sri Lanka, a constitutional change that can be accepted by all parties, all communities. We believe that should be the way forward. So we are seriously looking at all these angles.
And when is the floor test expected? Last question.
Sorry, I didn't get you.
When is the floor test expected in Parliament?
Well, it all depend on President Sirisena and the Cabinet to decide on which day they are ready to present the policies to the Parliament. Because, see, I must say that the Parliaments are provoked, not because of the number. We always had the number. But the President Sirisena decided to postpone Parliament from 11 days. Because it is not a postpone from 2 weeks, because anyway Parliament was due on Monday, 5th of November.
Right.
So the provocation should start from the 5th to 16th, not from the day he provoked it, because anyway Parliament was due on the 5th, not before that. So the provocation was done to get ready with the proposal, to get ready with the government policies, to get ready with what we're going to do for the next couple of months. Mm. So that's what took time. So once the President Sirisena and Prime Minister is ready with that, we are more than happy to go to the Parliament and show our strength there.
Sure. Namal Rajapaksa, thanks very much for speaking with us here on Wion and putting the Sri Lankan situation in perspective for our viewers. All the very best. Sri Lankan Parliament is a 225-member house, I can tell our viewers, and you need 113 to carry the day. We'll see how the floor test progresses. Thank you very much, Namal.